Chapter 2. 21 hours, 17 minutes. Captain Catherine Janeway sat in her command chair, staring at the viewscreen. Two stars were displayed on it, impossibly close together, yet not touching, not orbiting. Solar flares arced off them, bright shining orange streaks against the darkness as they ripped at each other. Both suns almost seemed to be boiling, like overheated oceans, their nearness to each other setting off unbelievable gravitational forces that had already ripped apart their planetary systems. Her bridge crew seemed as fascinated by the image as she was. Harry Kim looked up from his work, as if checking to make certain the suns were still there. Tom Paris occasionally took his attention away from his navigation duties to glance at the orange streaks before them. Chakotay stared at them directly, his fingers templed, obviously lost in thought. As fascinating as the suns were, she was not concentrating on them. She was thinking about the explosion of Seven's alcove, and the damage it had done. If she hadn't sent B'Elanna to get Seven, Seven would be dead now. Janeway did not believe the timing of the explosion was a coincidence. Especially since her crew could find nothing wrong with the systems. Nothing seemed to have malfunctioned, and there were no intruders on the ship. The explosion seemed to have happened for no reason at all. "Captain," Harry Kim said. "I'm getting some strange readings."
"In which system, Mr. Kim?"
"Not on Voyager." His words surprised her. She had thought he was searching for the cause of the explosion. She glanced at him. He looked puzzled and focused. "From something moving slowly away from the two suns."
"What kind of readings, Ensign?"
"A slight energy spike, as if something had exploded."
"On screen."
The image of the suns vanished, replaced by an area of space filled with asteroids. The entire region near the suns was filled with space junk, since the gravitational forces had pulled the two solar systems apart like so much tissue paper.
"Magnify."
Janeway stood as if standing gave her a better view of the screen. It didn't, but it helped her think. The image got larger, showing a long, thin, asteroid-like object. Then larger again. What she had thought was an asteroid was clearly constructed. It seemed to be very long and thin and round, like a straw.
"What is that?" she asked, peering forward.
Harry enlarged the image a third time, and this time it was clear. A huge black ship was making its way slowly out of the solar system. Only the ship wasn't all one piece. It was composed of a lot of different tube-like pieces. 10 tubes clustered on the outside, and the 11th was in the middle of each unit, protected by the other tubes. And there looked to be 6 different sections somehow tied together.
"Can you enlarge it further, Mr. Kim?"
The image grew one more time. Each section was composed of tubes that rotated on their own. She recognized the technology from her history. It looked like massive L5 colonies, O'Neill colonies, once proposed by Earth. Only a few of those had been built, and never at this scale. The ship was huge, ponderous, and extremely fragile. It also seemed to be venting material from one of the sections.
"Is this what I think it is?" Chakotay asked.
"It's a pre-warp ship, if you want to call it a ship," Tom Paris said, awe in his voice.
"I think a mobile colony might be a better term.
That thing looks huge.
Can you get readings from it, Mr. Kim?
Are there any life signs?" Janeway clasped her hands behind her back. Most pre-warp ships had little maneuverability, and almost no speed. If this thing was full of lives.
"I get life sign readings in the billions, Captain.
Over 800 million of them are humanoid. The rest seem to be lower life forms of some kind."
"An arc?" Chakotay asked softly.
"It would seem so," Janeway said.
"They got that thing out of the solar system," Paris said, the awe in his voice growing.
"It must have taken them years. Not to mention all the time it took to build the ship and then to board it." The scale amazed Janeway. She couldn't remember ever seeing anything of this size.
It was so big that Voyager would look almost like a bird flying down the middle of one of the smaller tubes.
What's venting?
It's not something from the engines, Kim said. They're attached on the sunward side.
Chakotay was also working his console.
I would have to guess that it's atmosphere.
Janeway let out a small breath.
Can you magnify a final time, Harry?
Once again the image grew.
Then it grew again, until it focused on the area sending plumes of white into space.
Two large holes marked the tube near its upper end.
One hole had been punched inward, the other outward.
The holes were the size of a small house.
There's an asteroid moving away from the ship, Harry said.
Looks like it punched through the tube.
They have no shields.
Paris sounded shocked.
And probably little else to protect them, Janeway said.
It's amazing they made it this far then, Chakotay said.
With all the debris around them, they should have been hit long before this.
Obviously the loss of a single tube won't cripple them, Janeway said.
But living beings are on that ship, Harry said.
The tube is filled with them.
Let's hope they have a way to repair the damage, Janeway said.
And quickly.
At the moment we're too far away to help immediately.
She glanced at Tom.
Move us closer, Mr. Paris, but keep us out of their sight.
They have smaller ships gathering around each opening, Harry said.
At the moment, Chakotay asked, glancing at her, picking up her thoughts as he often did.
She nodded.
The people who built this ship clearly came from one of those destroyed planets.
They're all that's left.
Paris ran a hand over his face, as if the idea was too much for him to take in.
And they seem awfully close to those suns to me.
Janeway returned to her command chair.
With a sureness born of long practice, she called up the preliminary figures on the suns that Torres had prepared for her.
Then she cross-checked the information with the data on the ship, locating its position in comparison to the explosion destruction area the coming collision would cause.
Captain.
Something must have shown on her face, because Chakotay spoke in his worried voice.
She lifted her gaze, met his.
For a moment, she let him see the shock she felt.
Then she covered it, became the captain again.
If B'Elanna is well enough to work, I want her to double-check these figures with 7 in astrometrics.
All right.
Chakotay didn't move, didn't relay the instruction.
What have you found?
She took a deep breath.
If these figures are correct, and I have no reason to doubt them, the suns will collide and explode in just over 21 hours.
The force from that will be.
Tom Paris's voice trailed off.
He whirled in his chair.
Unbelievable, yes.
She wasn't looking at Paris or Chakotay.
She turned her attention back to the viewscreen, to the tiny jet of atmosphere, leaking from the tube on the side of that giant ship.
You were right, weren't you, Chakotay said.
They're too close.
She nodded.
When those suns explode, that entire civilization will perish.
21 hours, 16 minutes.
Traveler continued to shake.
If the shock waves were this strong, so far away from Unit 3, Emperor Aetean had no idea what they'd be like, closer to the damage.
The shock waves themselves were a threat to Traveler's integrity.
The units were held together inside the massive structure, connected only by magnetic binding to allow each unit to rotate freely.
Too much shaking and the entire ship would just come apart.
Stabilize the ship, he cried, and his words echoed throughout the command center.
The jets have been firing, sir, said Commander Iris.
Aetean knew the jets were designed for just such an emergency. The ship's builders had anticipated more tragedies like this than they had experienced in the first 10 years.
Iris went on.
The impact was severe.
It will take most of the day to stabilize the ship.
But the waves had eased.
Aetean could feel that.
How is our structural integrity?
Iris looked toward Aquat, the operational commander of Traveler.
Iquat was a heavy-set man whose hair had turned an off shade of violet owing to all the stress of the past few years.
"Structural integrity, sir," Iris prompted.
Iquat raised his head, his hair falling into his face. He had burn scars along his neck and shoulders, which he'd suffered in an accident 2 years before, as Traveler had passed the last planet in the solar system. At the time, Etienne thought he was going to lose Iquat, but it hadn't happened, and Etienne had been relieved. Very few people had the focus, concentration, and sheer gall that it took to pilot a ship like Traveler.
"Repair crews are responding to the junctures," he said.
"Hope we don't need them, because many of our emergency ships are handling the breaches in the hull of Unit 3.
"This one is serious, Your Excellency."
Etienne sat down in his throne and studied the viewscreen. He'd purposely blocked out all thought of the deaths that had already occurred. But he would have to deal with them, and all the attendant problems, if the ship survived the next day. Why did emergencies have to pile one on top of another? He rubbed his nose with his first two fingers, hitting the relaxation pores on either side of the bridge. The action released mild endorphins that should have elevated his mood and dissipated some of the alarm he was feeling. But the action created no difference. The sense of impending doom nearly overwhelmed him. He forced himself to concentrate on the emergency ships, now visible on his viewscreen. The ships had already formed a wedge over the openings and were covering it with a metallic blanket-like seal. There was a name for that stuff, but Etienne couldn't remember what it was. It had been described to him over 11 years ago, he'd never seen it in action before. The ships pressed the seal onto the hull, where it adhered to the surface. Once the opening was covered, crews would do the same on the inside and then repair the remaining cracks. He imagined it as if a small hole had appeared in the corridors near the command center. A hole in the metal, nothing more. But he knew that wasn't accurate. Unit 3, as all the other units, had been designed to replicate part of a continent, and somewhere inside it, some region, some city had just experienced a catastrophic event. He had to put himself back in Ronian mode, and act the way his father had when natural disasters had struck regions of the planet. Etienne had only been emperor for 12 days when the ship had been completed. He hadn't dealt with disasters, natural or otherwise. Or at least, disasters that had a direct impact on his subjects on Ron, or inside this ship. He tried not to think about all the subjects who had chosen not to follow him onto Traveler. Chosen not to, or had been unable to afford to. They were over 8 years dead. He'd watched the destruction of his home planet on this very viewscreen and imagined he heard the faint voices of his subjects who had decided to remain there, who had hoped beyond hope that the scientists had been wrong, or who had decided that the Sky Singers would save them. But the Sky Singers had proven themselves to be myths, not gods, and the scientists had been right. What had it been like in that last year, when the land trembled all the time, when the volcanoes blew and storms covered the planet's surface? He would know the answers soon enough, he supposed. The slight shock waves that had jolted the command center were just the beginning. Unless his scientists discovered a way to get Traveler to move even faster, these deaths today were just the beginning. The beginning of the end to his entire species. 20 hours, 55 minutes. The jolting waves had stopped. The floor no longer moved, although she still felt vibrations. The entire unit no longer shook. Lispa was wedged between two trees, their branches poking her, their leaves covering her face. The leaves smelled faintly of wet soil, reminding her of days she'd spent playing in the forests as a child. Forests, now gone. She brushed the leaves off her face and sat up. Bruised, scratched, but alive. All around her, people were moving again, if they could. Carts were overturned, food was everywhere, and above her, one of the reinforced clear windows had cracked. Through it, she could see emergency ships drifting nearby. She glanced at her wrist. Her summons watch had been destroyed. She should have been outside, flying the ships, using all that training, the training she had paid so much for, the training that had, ultimately, gotten her and Andra off Ron.
Andra.
Lispa rubbed a hand over her face, felt the stickiness of blood. She looked at her fingers, saw the deep mauve that indicated she was bleeding more than she should have been, which probably accounted for her lack of concentration. But she didn't feel injured. She sat up slowly, trying to pick her daughter's voice out of the moans and cries.
Nothing.
Andra? Lispa could no longer see where they had been standing before the accident occurred. That part of the floor was buried beneath chairs and bodies and carts that had slid in that direction.
Bodies.
Lispa pulled herself out of the trees, scraping her hands on the branches, feeling the scaly bark cut into her skin. She didn't care. She had to find her daughter and she had to do it soon. The feeling in her ears had eased a little. The pressure inside the section had stabilized, or it had stabilized enough that the environmental systems had come back on, using way too much energy while the tube was repaired. Eventually, it would be self-sustaining again. That was how it was designed. Beneath the tree's massive trunk, legs stuck out. Legs encased in striped pantaloons, showing that they belonged to one of the vendors. She pushed aside some ripped branches, saw that the vendor's eyes were open and a bubble of blood was on his lips. He was dead. She raised her head quickly then, trying to deny the panic welling within her.
Andra.
Still no answer from her daughter. Her precious daughter. Lispa stumbled away from the trees, toward the raised area of the floor where she and Andra had been standing not too long ago. As she moved, a hand caught her ankle and she nearly fell. She looked down. The hand was attached to a blood-covered arm, which was attached to a blood-covered girl, with familiar pale eyes.
Andra.
Lispa crouched. Her daughter's mouth moved, but no sound came out. They had been this close to each other and she hadn't known it.
Andra was alive.
The joy mingled with the all-too-familiar fear. Small burns covered the oxygen holes in her neck, making it impossible to feed air to her voice box. At least her nose was undamaged, and so were the breathing holes on her collarbone. Lispa hesitated to touch her daughter, afraid of making the injuries worse. Then she saw the blood smears along the clear floor. Andra had pulled herself toward her mother, probably in response to her voice.
"Oh, baby," Lispa said, as she examined her daughter.
Andra's face was bruised and covered with small burns. Apparently she had been hit with hot dealies from one of the vendor's carts. They left little square burns all over Andra's body. But the burns didn't look that serious to Lispa, not incapacitating anyway. Although her medical training was limited. A year-long course for pilots, specializing in injuries that could occur aboard small ships, like one of the hundreds of scouts that clung to the outside of Traveler like burrs. One day, she had hoped to pilot a scout from Traveler to a new homeland, ferrying passengers to that new planet as she had ferried them off of Ron.
"Oh, baby," Lispa said again. Her daughter had never been injured before, had hardly ever been sick in her entire life.
"Can you walk?" Andra pointed to her left foot. It was a mass of blood and tissue, with a bit of bone peeking through. Her right wasn't much better. That explained the drag marks.
Andra couldn't walk.
Lispa took a deep breath. Her training had specified calmness. She had to remain calm to take care of a patient, even if that patient was her own child. She cast about for help, but saw that very few people in the wreck area appeared ambulatory. Pots and chairs clogged the main entrance to the viewing area. Obviously they had gathered there when the hull had breached and now that it was sealed, or sealed enough, they had ceased moving. Lispa couldn't climb through that entrance with an injured child. Besides, the damage had to be worse there. She glanced at the doors at the other end of the view area. The signs tilted sideways, but were still there.
"Do not enter.
Juncture point. Authorized personnel only." Andra caught her gaze and shook her head. Crossing into new sections was completely forbidden without a work visa or special papers. They had neither. And they would be charged with illegal trespass.
It's an emergency, Andra, Lispa said. They should be opening that door any moment. It was the only way that outside rescue personnel could enter.
And they had to enter, once Emperor Aten gave them permission to cross the junctures.
Each section would have to send aid.
That was how Traveler's Charter had been set up.
Near the main entrance a woman screamed.
It sounded as if she had just awakened and discovered her predicament.
But the scream was a single one-shot thing.
She didn't cry out again.
Andra looked in that direction and so did Lispa.
A man leaned over the woman.
He'd helped her, set a bone maybe, or reattached a dislocated shoulder.
I'll speak to him, Lispa said.
She kissed her hand and touched it lightly to her daughter's hair, streaked and matted now with blood, then made her way across the wreck area.
The floor was still shuddering, but not as bad as before.
The movement made her feel unsteady on her feet.
So too, did her own injuries, slight as they were.
Amazing how she could have felt so good a moment before and so disoriented now.
Until she stood, she hadn't given any thought to the rest of Traveler.
She had assumed only Unit 3 had been damaged, but what if units all over the ship had been harmed?
What if she took her daughter through that juncture point, only to discover something worse?
It wasn't possible.
If that had happened, the emergency ships wouldn't have arrived so quickly.
Unit 3 was one of the poorer regions on Traveler.
The ships would have gone to the Emperor first, and then to Unit 1, where the Council met.
More trees had fallen all along the clear floor, and beneath some of them, she could hear moaning.
A steaming pile of OS ooze beside yet another overturned cart, and beyond it, some melting ice was mixing with the blood and goo.
Soon this would all start to smell bad, and that wasn't even counting the bodies.
She finally made it to the man and woman.
She hadn't seen them before, or perhaps she hadn't noticed them, not with all the other people in the section.
The woman was covered with dirt from a shattered pot that had, only moments before, housed a decorative shrub.
She was turning her hand over and over, examining the palm and the back as if it belonged to someone else.
The man stared at her movements, studying them.
He had helped her then.
Lispa tapped him on the shoulder.
He turned to her, his pale peach skin streaked with dried blood.
He was covered with scratches just as she was.
I was wondering if you had medical training.
I'm interning.
His voice sounded hollow, as if he were reciting the part for a play.
This hadn't become real to him yet.
My daughter, she's badly injured and she can't even speak.
Please.
I don't have my equipment.
Just my bag.
His voice trailed off as he cast around him.
He felt the ground, then shook his head.
I guess I don't even have that.
Please, Lispa said.
I need to know if I can move her.
That got the woman's attention.
She stopped turning her hand and looked up.
That entrance is good and blocked, and I don't think we want to go beyond it.
There's emergency ships outside.
We can wait for them.
You can, maybe, Lispa said.
But I'm not sure my daughter can.
Please.
She looked at the man again.
He nodded, then touched the woman lightly on the shoulder.
Are you up to joining us?
It was just my arm, Siyat.
The woman sounded annoyed.
He didn't seem to notice.
He stood, then helped her up, both of them swaying slightly as they adjusted to the shuddering floor.
Lispa exhaled, and felt some of the panic leave.
It was better to have another set of eyes on Andra.
Lispa was competent, but competency didn't always work with one's own child.
Bias came into play, especially with a child as precious as Andra, the only remaining part of her father, and the only child Lispa would ever have.
She could see her daughter near the down trees, propped up on her elbows, watching.
Andra looked thinner and younger than she had only moments before.
It had to be a trick caused by the blood, the light, and the strangeness.
Siyat walked slower than Lispa wanted.
He glanced at the overturned carts, the ruined chairs, the cluster of trees.
People are trapped.
Lispa nodded,
feeling the panic rise again. We can help them in a moment. Please. My daughter's vocal airholes are blocked. I'm afraid. He put a hand on her shoulder, and she winced. He hit a bruise. I'll help her, he said, if you help me. Lispa shot one more desperate glance at the tilted signs above the juncture doors. Of course I'll help, she said, wondering if she lied. 20 hours, 42 minutes. Janeway stopped outside the briefing room door and gathered herself. This meeting had to go quickly. A lot was happening, and she wanted to make certain both she and the senior staff were up to speed. It always amazed her that the ship could run smoothly for weeks, encounter nothing out of the ordinary, and then, suddenly, everything came apart. It was as if she were being tested, as if each new obstacle was greater than the last. Then she smiled. She didn't have the ego to believe she was the focal point of the universe. She had met other captains who did, but she had never been one of them. And with that thought, she stepped inside the conference room, the door hissing open and revealing her senior staff gathered around the table. In some ways, she felt more comfortable in this room than she did in her own quarters. Its plush setting and harsh lighting was conducive to creative thought. She had learned a lot here, both from herself and from her crew. Chakotay sat at his normal spot near the head of the table. B'Elanna sat across from him, Tom Paris beside her. They had been holding hands beneath the table and B'Elanna had pulled away as Janeway entered the room. Janeway pretended not to notice. Harry Kim had seen the movement though, and had given Tom an amused look. B'Elanna glared at Harry, but her fierceness didn't seem to bother him. Tuvok was studying a pad at the opposite end of the table, and Seven stared at him, seemingly lost in thought. The doctor was leaning back in a chair, humming. It sounded like Wagner to Janeway's unpracticed ear, but she couldn't be certain. He'd taken to composing his own music lately and it was a bit derivative, although she hadn't told him that. As she walked to her place at the end of the table, she opened the meeting. Before we get to our mystery ship, I want to know what caused the explosion in Seven's alcove. Mr. Tuvok. Tuvok looked up from his pad. He set it on the table and folded his hands over it so that Seven, who was peering at it, couldn't read it. Our examination of the area was inconclusive, Captain. Inconclusive? Janeway sat down. I don't like that word. I am simply stating fact, Tuvok said. The debris held nothing unusual. We found no evidence of a bomb or an intruder. I trust you ran a systems check, Janeway said. It too was inconclusive. Surely you found something, Mr. Tuvok. No, Captain, he said. We did not. You're telling me that the alcove simply exploded. There was no reason for it. None that we could determine. Tuvok slid the pad closer to his body. I did ask Lieutenant Torres to assist me after our initial investigation. Seven raised her head slightly and Janeway thought she noted irritation in Seven's expression. Sometimes it was hard to tell. Seven often looked irritated. That emotion seemed to be the default setting for her face. Lieutenant Torres's investigation also proved inconclusive, Tuvok was saying. I wouldn't say that. B'Elanna leaned toward Janeway. We were able to rule out a number of things. Such as? A bomb, as Tuvok said. Intruders. A slow systems malfunction. Whatever happened, happened quickly. Nothing out of the ordinary went on before the explosion, at least nothing that our computer records caught. I checked and double-checked the information and I saw no unusual readings. Seven's lips pursed and her eyes narrowed. Janeway turned to her. Do you have something to add, Seven? No. Seven's voice was laced with contempt, and she shot a not-so-subtle glare at Tuvok. He didn't seem to notice. So what could have caused this? Janeway asked B'Elanna. Several things, B'Elanna said. Any changes in the regeneration program might have initiated a sequence that was unique to the alcove. We're not completely familiar with Borg technology.
I am, Seven said.
Something seems to be bothering you, Seven, Janeway said.
What is it?
Lieutenant Torres and Commander Tuvok seem to believe that this is some kind of strange systems malfunction.
And you don't?
My experiences have taught me to be extremely cautious, Captain. The doctor insists that he monitor my implants, and I do the same with the alcove. Every night before I go into my regeneration cycle, I run a systems diagnostic. If there was a problem, I would not have entered the alcove.
Janeway stared at her for a moment.
Seven seemed more disturbed by this than she was letting on. And who could blame her, after all? This was her private place, her resting place.
I just said that the problem did not show up in the system before the event occurred, B'Elanna snarled.
Tom touched her hand and B'Elanna jerked away, calling more attention to his movement than it deserved.
Could something have happened that our systems were unable to detect? Janeway asked.
Unlikely, Captain, Tuvok said.
That would suggest the presence of some outside force.
There is none.
Except that ship out there.
Tom Paris nodded toward the viewscreen.
With pre-warp technology.
Harry Kim shook his head.
If they knew how to tamper with Voyager, you'd think they'd have built a faster ship.
We'll get to that ship in a moment, Janeway said.
I'm still unsettled by the notion that we might not pick up a serious flaw.
B'Elanna, I want you to run every systems check you can think of down to the smallest level, and then I'd like you to run them again, just to make certain you haven't missed anything.
Voyager has been traveling now for years without a starbase overhaul.
We have to expect strange things to go wrong.
I didn't get a chance to finish, Captain, B'Elanna said, with a bit too much edge in her voice.
I think we should consider the possibility that this may be nothing more than a compatibility issue.
Maybe the problem stemmed from a fault in the interface between the Borg technology and ours.
The explosion is consistent with an overload, as if our systems couldn't handle something on the Borg end.
There is nothing wrong with the Borg technology, Seven said.
I thought we set up the alcove in such a way to avoid mishaps, Janeway observed.
We did.
Seven folded her hands in an unconscious imitation of Tuvok's.
Ordinarily Borg technology overrides and assimilates foreign technology, forcing it to conform to Borg parameters.
But in order to preserve the integrity of Voyager systems, the alcove technology was modified to be non-invasive, necessitating the less efficient interface.
That's one of the many reasons I ran the nightly diagnostic.
Diagnostics aren't cure-alls, B'Elanna said, and there may be an answer in those pieces of the alcove that we haven't investigated yet.
Well, investigate them, Janeway said.
In the meantime, make sure the other alcoves are safe for Seven to use.
She needs downtime, just like the rest of us do.
More, the doctor murmured.
Seven glared at him.
He didn't seem to notice.
That might not be such a good idea, said Torres.
Janeway frowned.
You think the other alcoves may malfunction as well?
Until we know what caused it, we won't know how to prevent it.
B'Elanna sounded surly.
Are you saying it's not safe for her to regenerate? Janeway asked.
B'Elanna shook her head.
No.
But I think that Seven will need to be cautious.
I am always cautious, Seven said.
Perhaps within her definition of cautious, Janeway thought.
She sometimes seemed impulsive to Janeway.
But she certainly didn't want anything to happen to Seven.
She had become a valuable member of the crew and along the way, she had become more than a project to Janeway.
She had become as important as everyone else sitting around this table.
They had come too close to losing Seven for Janeway's comfort.
Well, Janeway said, let's make certain that we run extra diagnostics before you use any of the other alcoves.
Seven pursed her lips again and was probably going to inform Janeway that her diagnostics were always thorough, but Janeway jumped in with the next part of the meeting.
Now, let's discuss that alien ship, if ship is the term we should use.
Mr. Paris thinks that the term is, inadequate.
I've seen cities smaller than that ship, Paris said.
I haven't been briefed on it, the doctor said.
What ship?
Janeway suppressed a smile.
The doctor always believed he was behind on everything, even though this meeting was the briefing to inform everyone of the ship.
Mr. Kim.
Harry Kim stood beside the viewscreen, which now held the image of the alien vessel.
It's a pre-warp colony ship, he said.
It consists of 6 sections and in each section are 11 habitat pods that rotate.
We'll get to those specifics in a moment, Janeway said.
The important thing here is that we have found at least 800 million sentient life forms on that ship.
They've clearly come from one of the destroyed solar systems.
That ship is a last-ditch effort to save their species.
How could a pre-warp culture get that far outside their solar system? The doctor asked.
They're not that far, B'Elanna said.
That's right, Tom said.
Not nearly far enough.
Then they will perish, Seven said, with her dramatic flair for the obvious.
Unless we do something.
Janeway nodded.
Captain, if they're pre-warp, we can't do anything, Chakotay said.
The Prime Directive
doesn't apply here, Commander, Tuvok said.
If you recall how General Order No. 1 is worded, we are unrestricted in these circumstances.
Janeway leaned back in her chair.
She had planned on discussing the Prime Directive, but not so soon.
Oh, Paris asked.
How do you figure?
Among its many particulars, the Prime Directive states that Starfleet personnel may not interfere with the natural development of a pre-warp society.
This, clearly, is not the natural development of this society.
You could make the case that it is, Paris said.
After all, the stellar collision that put them in this mess is a natural phenomenon.
If they, hell.
I can't believe I'm arguing to let all those people die.
I can't believe you're doing it either.
Torres crossed her arms.
This isn't an intellectual exercise.
Nor are we going to interfere with their normal development, Janeway said.
We're going to enable it.
This species has clearly shown its desire to live.
It's simply miscalculated.
Had that ship left their planet a year earlier, it would have survived on its own.
Maybe it did, Kim said.
Maybe something happened that slowed it down.
Like the asteroid, Paris asked.
The crew members who hadn't been on the bridge when the ship was discovered seemed surprised.
Asteroid, Ensign, Tuvok asked, showing as much surprise as he was capable of.
That's how we discovered it, Kim said.
I noticed small explosions that were caused when an asteroid crashed into this section of the ship.
He pointed to the damaged tube.
The image was taken later than the initial ones, and it showed small ships outside the larger one, repairing the damage.
Janeway was even more impressed at how well the aliens had planned.
I don't understand how something this big could have made it outside a solar system, the doctor said.
Isn't that why warp technology was invented, to make such travel possible?
To make such travel viable, doctor, Janeway said.
It was possible before that, but this is the first culture I've encountered that found such a trip necessary without warp technology.
In fact, we could argue, and I probably will in my log, that because this species has ventured so far out of its normal environs, it's at least attempted to prepare itself for the possibility of first contact with another civilization.
Within that context, it meets the criteria of a warp culture.
There is a certain logic to that, Tuvok said.
One cannot assume that every culture will develop in the same way.
Some cultures may not ever achieve warp technology while they might achieve its ends.
Philosophers within the Federation have argued this part of the restriction for decades now, and have yet to come to a satisfactory conclusion.
Well, Janeway said, like B'Elanna, I do not want to consider allowing this civilization to disappear.
We have to find a way to help them.
That monster ship presents all kinds of problems, B'Elanna said.
It's the most fragile thing I've ever seen.
How are they keeping that thing moving together? Tom asked.
Ingenious thinking, B'Elanna said.
I'll agree with that, Janeway said.
From my scan, Kim said, I've figured out this much. Each habitat pod is connected to the overall superstructure by what appears to be a magnetic coupling that allows each environment to rotate for the gravity inside, yet at the same time keeping it connected to every other tube through a massive, frame-like superstructure.
How do they propel this thing? The doctor asked.
I thought such colonies were supposed to be stationary.
I think Lieutenant Torres's word is apt, Janeway said.
This is an ingenious system.
The aliens have used over 300 atomic fission engines for propulsion, all bunched in a large unit on the end.
Most likely their control room is on the opposite end.
Primitive sublight technology, Seven said.
I do not know how you can compare it to warp.
Janeway smiled at her.
Maybe because they made it work.
It shouldn't work, B'Elanna said.
The thrust from those engines on such a massive structure should have caused it to shake or twist apart long before now.
That was my first thought, Janeway said.
But they came up with a solution, which I find quite impressive.
Mr. Kim.
They use thousands of steering thrusters, Harry said.
Positioned along the superstructure, they fire when they're needed to make any adjustments in any part of the ship.
The thrusters compensate for the force of the main engines, keeping the ship stable.
It's an incredibly complex system, but without the thrusters, the entire thing would have shaken apart before it even got moving.
They built a spaceship practically out of spit and glue, and somehow they almost got it outside their solar system.
Tom Paris shook his head once with admiration and awe.
Of course we have to help them.
Are we certain they won't make it? The doctor asked.
After all, we don't want to interfere if we don't have to.
Good point, Doctor.
Janeway put her hands firmly on the table.
We're reasonably certain, but we have to be absolutely certain.
Seven, B'Elanna, I need those exact figures from you immediately.
I, Captain, B'Elanna said.
However, in the meantime, Janeway said, we'll have to operate on the assumption that this ship will be destroyed in that explosion.
I need suggestions, people, on how to save it.
Hard to know where to begin, said Paris.
That thing is so big, its size alone limits our options.
How do you help something almost 200 kilometers long and tied together with basically baling wire?
A tractor beam would shred it, even if it could handle the weight and size, B'Elanna said.
This thing is so fragile that I'm afraid to touch it.
Maybe we could find a way to boost their engines, Seven said.
That might shred them too, B'Elanna said.
Now you're beginning to understand our dilemma, Janeway said.
We don't have much time.
I want some solutions, people, and I want them quickly.
Is that understood?
She was answered with nods all around.
She stood.
Meeting dismissed.
The staff pushed their chairs back and stood also.
Janeway started out of the room, but Chakotay caught her arm.
Catherine, he said softly.
Are we even certain that these people will take our help?
At this moment, we're not sure of anything, she said, and let herself out of the room.
20 hours, 20 minutes.
Emperor Aitain remained rooted to his throne, ignoring the cacophony around him. His command center staff was giving orders, receiving information, and making certain that Traveler held together. They were doing their jobs. And, in a strange way, he was doing his. He was touring the devastation using his viewscreen. Many of the areas were blanked out. There was no reception at all. But from the areas on the fringe, he was getting a sense of the damage. And from what he could tell, damage was too small a word. The asteroid had hit the unit about a third of the way from the front end. He assumed that the destruction anywhere near those holes was total. About halfway down, the unit reception picked up and he could see fairly well. Homes had slid off their foundations, trees were down, buildings had been crumpled like sticks. Farther on, the damage seemed less and less. But he wasn't looking at the actual physical damage as much as he was watching his people. They were pulling each other from the wreckage, tending each other's wounds, comforting each other in grief. They were taking heroic measures to save a small child from a collapsed building, pulling drowning people from a nearby river, using combined strength to pull vehicles, filled with families, out of what had become instant mud. His people were going about the business of survival, even though he knew most of them only had a day to live. Survival. He clicked from image to image. Survival everywhere he looked. The instinct was so strong in them. He rested his head on his chin, watching doctors perform triage in a makeshift medical center. So many clogged airholes, thank the skies for redundancy, so many fractured limbs, so many bleeding and near-death patients, all struggling to continue living one more day. Somewhere in the last year, he had given up, succumbed to the inevitability of loss. As the statistics and hard data had come in, saying that Traveler had not gone far enough, that the explosion caused by the colliding suns would destroy her, he had nodded sagely, and accepted the information. Accepted it, as if they had no other choice. He had doomed his people. He had gotten them this far, and he hadn't fought to get them farther. He had accepted the fatalism around him, overwhelmed by the task before him. It had taken the disaster on Unit 3 to wake him up to the fact that he should be getting his hands dirty, pulling bleeding people from the wreckage, struggling to give them at least one more day of life. He sat up and signaled impatiently with his right hand. Commander Gillette appeared at his side. "Get me my car." Gillette looked at the images playing on the viewscreen. "It's too soon to tour the devastation." Touring the devastation. That was the job of a head of state, a man with little power and too much time on his hands. Etienne was no longer going to be that man. "I'm not going to Unit 3," he said. "I'm going to the island." "Beg pardon, Your Highness, but at this moment, the scientists cannot help Unit 3. They..." "Get my car," Etienne said sharply. "And send some of our top technicians to meet me there." "Your Highness. What part of my request do you not understand?" Gillette straightened, but Etienne saw the shock on his face. How long had he let his reign slip? How long had he let his unimaginative but capable commanders run this ship? Too long. Was it too late? He refused to believe that. There had to be time to save Traveler. He would pull his people out before there was wreckage. He had to. There was no other choice. 20 hours, 10 minutes. 7 of 9, strode toward Astrometrics. She had to recheck those figures for the captain, and then she had to figure out how to prevent future problems in her regeneration alcoves. She would worry about that after she confirmed their current data on the stellar collision. Lieutenant Torres had returned to engineering to find the figures lost in the explosion. She had said she would meet Seven shortly in Astrometrics. Seven planned to have most of the work done by then. She could use Torres's help on the rebuilding of the alcove. Perhaps the two of them could discuss ways to save the alien ship while they were patching up the cargo bay. She had just reached the door to Astrometrics when her comm badge chirped. 7 of 9, please report to the shuttle bay. She did not recognize the voice, although it was vaguely familiar. Female and not the captain's. But right now the captain was busy with several things and it was not that unusual for her to delegate the task of contacting her crew members to someone else. 7 tapped her comm badge. "Acknowledged," she said. She hoped that this diversion in the shuttle bay would not take too much of her time. She wanted to have those figures complete before Torres arrived in Astrometrics. She entered the turbolift. "Deck 10, she said. The ride to the shuttle bay was short, but it seemed long. 7 felt the seconds ticking away. Whatever caused her summons had better be good. She exited the turbolift and headed into the shuttle bay, leaving the corridor door open behind her. The lights were dim. The shuttles looked more like shadows than ships. She thought that was odd. She took one more step inside, her footsteps echoing on the floor. It didn't feel like anyone else was in here. Now that was annoying. Had someone called her away from her duties on a whim? Seven stopped beside the Delta Flyer, and rapped on its side. No one answered. Not even Tom Paris was here, fiddling with his favorite toy. She was about to tap her comm badge when the doors to the corridor slammed shut and chirruped as they did when they vacuum locked. Her breath caught. The corridor doors only locked like that when a shuttle was about to leave. Sure enough, the bay doors rolled open and the air inside vented into space. The atmospheric force field that was ordinarily in place to prevent exactly such an occurrence was obviously inoperative. Only her Borg-enhanced reflexes saved her from being blown into vacuum. Seven managed to grab onto the Delta Flyer, holding on with all her strength. She had only a matter of seconds. Perhaps less if the craft wasn't massive enough to withstand the hurricane force wind. The Delta Flyer suddenly started to skid across the deck. Seven slammed her fist on the flyer's door. It opened. She grabbed both sides of the doorframe and held herself in place. The force, pulling her toward the open bay doors, was incredible. It took all of her strength to hold herself in position. She wasn't sure she could throw herself inside the flyer. But she had to. With all her strength, she flung herself inside, then wheeled around and manually closed the flyer's door, not willing to let any air out of her lungs. The flyer's door closed. The ship's environmental system automatically replenished the lost atmosphere. She took a deep breath. Air had never felt so good. She made her way to the cockpit and peered through its viewport into the bay. The Delta Flyer had slid to halt just a few meters from the edge of the flight deck. No shuttle exited. No shuttle entered. "Computer," she said. "Who else is in the shuttle bay?" "The shuttle bay is empty." "What about the other shuttlecraft?" "The other shuttlecraft are empty." She sank into the flyer's command chair. Not a malfunction. She had been targeted deliberately. Again. Someone had lured her here and set the bay doors to open when she arrived. Luck and her quick thinking had saved her. Otherwise she would have been blown out into space, to die painfully. Of all the deaths she knew of, dying unprotected in space was the one that she feared the most. She would never confess that to anyone. She had only put it in her personal logs once and then erased it immediately. And she had never told a soul. This was an attack of convenience, a startlingly easy attack, at that. It would take little to set up, and even less effort to execute it. She raised a shaking hand to her face, struggling for composure. Not a malfunction. The attack had been personal. Someone on Voyager wanted her dead. One of her friends and colleagues had tried to kill her. Twice. Not a malfunction. End of part 2. This book will be released in segments each week on our YouTube channel, free of charge. However, to help support the costs involved in creating this audiobook, the entire book is available now to our Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to the entire book early, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. And now, please enjoy a preview of our Patreon exclusive book series, Starfleet Academy. Star Trek. Starfleet Academy. Book 2. Aftershock. Written by John Vornholt. Audiobook adaptation by YJK Audiobooks. Preview. Cadet Leonard McCoy is a medical student at Starfleet Academy and is looking forward to the winter break. But when a terrible earthquake strikes the planet Playamar, McCoy begins to question if this is truly a natural disaster or the result of something more sinister. Chapter 1. Leonard H. McCoy heaved a sigh and sunk his bony frame into a plush armchair. It was too plush, because too many Starfleet cadets had sunk into it over the years. A spring stuck him in the rump, which only added to his grumpiness. He bolted to his feet and set his electronic clipboard on the table. McCoy looked a bit odd, standing there in his gray cadet jumpsuit with a white bathrobe over his shoulders, but he always found the dormitory lounge to be cold. Heck, all of San Francisco is cold to this southern boy. It was late, his roommate was snoring, and McCoy had to study for an exam in metabolic stasis procedures. Weird instruments, keeping people alive indefinitely, it wasn't his favorite kind of medicine, and he was worried about tomorrow's test. McCoy wasn't a doctor yet, just a medical student. He was a transfer student too, so he was a little older than most of the new cadets at Starfleet Academy. He did fine in his studies, but he still didn't feel part of the academy lifestyle. So many of the younger cadets wanted to be explorers and starship captains. They knew exactly what they wanted, but McCoy just wanted to survive day by day. Cadets were dropping out of the academy med school every day, because it was tougher than regular schools. He must have been crazy to come here. Also, McCoy hated to admit that he was homesick. He was from a little town in Georgia, and he hadn't been home in several years. But he was going home over the winter break. Just one more week to go. McCoy could see the old Civil War monument in the town square, the Spanish moss hanging from the oaks, and the red clay banks of the lake. His dad would be catching lots of fat catfish and bluegills by now. He wanted to be there, helping him catch, clean, and eat those whoppers. It was hard to imagine that he would get 2 whole weeks off from his crushing schedule. Thoughts of fried catfish and long naps on the porch kept him going through this last terrible week of exams. McCoy's homesick daydream was interrupted by Hibolta, a big hairless Delosian. He rushed through the lobby and pointed at the cadet. "Good, you're still up." "Why is that good?" grumbled McCoy. "I'd rather be asleep." "Stay awake, McCoy." The Delosian charged off. McCoy just shook his head. Everybody at the academy called everybody by their last name. So he was beginning to think of himself as McCoy instead of Leonard. It was just one more adjustment he had to make to life at the academy. He had finally settled into a safe spot on the sofa and was picking up his clipboard, when a squad of cadets burst into the lounge. Hibolta was in the lead, along with Wainwright, a big blonde cadet.
"Okay, McCoy," said Hibolta. "You're with us."
"I'm with you," drawled McCoy. "What on earth are you talking about?" Wainwright stepped forward. "Come on, McCoy, the freshman dorm has challenged us to a game of touch football. Our honor is on the line." McCoy sat up at the mention of football, a fine, old Southern tradition. It wasn't an official sport at Starfleet Academy, but it hung around, refusing to die. Sometimes he played football with the guys, when he was trying to fit in, but tonight he had too much studying to do.
"You boys go ahead," said McCoy. "I plan to go to bed tonight without any broken bones."
"It's just touch football," said Hibolta. "And we've only got 10 guys, we're one short."
"And we know you can catch the ball," added Wainwright.
"You can't do much else, but you can do that." McCoy scoffed at the offhand compliment.
"You make it sound like lots of fun, but I've got to study."
"Better we play with 10 guys than with him," said another cadet. "He's just a coward." Now McCoy bolted upright in his seat. Somebody is going to have to take back that last remark. There was a chorus of shouts.
"Come on and play.
McCoy, we need you."
"All right," grumbled McCoy as he dragged himself to his feet. He supposed he should be flattered that they asked him to play. Of course, there was nobody else awake at 2 o'clock in the morning. He followed his ragtag teammates out the door, down a sidewalk, to the campus green. The green was a big field at the center of the academy, a pleasant place to pass a few moments on the way from one class to another. It had a well-lit, well-manicured lawn, perfect for touch football. McCoy shivered in the cool ocean breeze,
wishing he was still wearing his bathrobe. Under the moonlight and the flood lamps, he could see the other team starting to gather. Just a bunch of pathetic, first-year cadets, he told himself. Nothing to worry about. They weren't really supposed to be doing this, of course. At 2 o'clock in the morning, who was going to find out? In one way, he decided, it was good for them to cast off some of the tension that came with final exams. The campus green had seen plenty of impromptu football games over the years. Okay, the babies are here, said Wainwright, referring to the underclassmen. McCoy sometimes saw women in these games, but not tonight. They had better sense, he guessed. A cocky freshman bounced out of the crowd and pointed at the upperclassmen. Are we here to play or talk? Play, play, came the cry from both sides. That was when McCoy noticed that the team of freshmen had many more than 11 players, while his team had only 11. They could substitute players, and his team couldn't. That was McCoy's first hint that they were going to have trouble with these upstarts. They flipped a coin, and his team lost. 11 players from each side took the field. McCoy watched Hibolta line up the ball, step back, and kick off. The game was underway. McCoy whirled around to see two freshmen steaming toward him. Both of them were trying to block him, and he didn't even have a chance to duck. They fell on top of him, burying him in the thick grass. Touch football meant no tackling, but it didn't mean no blocking. Luckily, his teammates tagged the runner before he got very far. McCoy stood up and looked angrily at his grass-stained jumpsuit. Now they had made him mad. McCoy chose to play pass defense. He would let somebody else smash into the big guys at the line. The first-year cadets tried to run on their first play, and Hibolta tagged the runner at the goal line. The upperclass team hooted in victory, but that was only one play. It's hard to run in touch football, thought McCoy. This time they'll try a pass. The wide out, McCoy shouted, as the younger cadets broke from their huddle. You take him, yelled Wainwright. McCoy looked at the muscular cadet across from him. It was one of those who had blocked him on the kickoff. The sandy-haired cadet looked like a born athlete, and McCoy wasn't sure he could win a foot race with him. But he was sure the pass was going to go right at him. The ball was hiked, and the young cadet streaked down the side of the lawn. McCoy tried to stay ahead of him, but it was a losing proposition. Just as the ball was thrown, McCoy stuck out his leg and tripped the freshman. The ball sailed harmlessly over their heads. Hey, you tripped me, complained the cadet as he jumped to his feet. McCoy shrugged. It's hard to play out here in the moonlight. Sometimes your feet get tangled up. Yeah, right, grumbled the kid. The next play, they tried a sweep around the side, away from McCoy. The runner had good blocking, and he made 20 meters before Wainwright pushed him off his feet. That was the trouble with touch football, the touch could get a little hard. The next play was going to be another pass, McCoy could feel it. He saw the sandy-haired cadet he had tripped, he was lining up in the backfield, McCoy would have to cover somebody else, but he was sure that the ball was going to the cocky young cadet. When the ball was snapped, McCoy ignored the man he was supposed to cover and raced across the field to try to break up the pass. He was too late, as the muscular cadet raced by the defender and caught the ball in stride. McCoy had good position, but the kid danced left and right, trying to fake him out. McCoy finally threw himself at the kid's feet, and he trampled him and just kept running. Hey, I touched you, groaned McCoy from the ground. The young man ran back and grinned at him. Yeah, you were lucky. Come on, let's stop them, yelled Wainwright. Hey, McCoy, get there faster next time. He wasn't even my man, grumbled McCoy as he picked himself up. The underclass dorm put in almost a whole new team for the next series of plays. Three plays later, they scored a touchdown on the panting upperclassmen. Uh-oh, thought McCoy. This could be a long night. But at least they were going to get the ball, finally. The freshman kicked off, and the ball sailed over McCoy's head to the man behind him. He looked around for somebody to block, and there was that same cocky freshman. McCoy tried to block him, but he never laid a finger on the kid. The upperclass dorm finally got a chance to score. In the huddle, Wainwright looked directly at McCoy. Line up right and go long. Milkins, you go short across the middle. Lecamore, you go to the flats and wait. You're the dump-off man. Everyone else, block. McCoy was not surprised when he lined up and saw the same muscular sandy-haired cadet lining up across from him. Well, it was time to show this kid a thing or two. Wainwright grunted a few times, and the center hiked the ball. McCoy started toward the middle, then broke toward the outside. He hoped that would fake out the kid, but he was right with him step for step. Wainwright had to throw it to the short man who only made a few yards. The young cadet was smiling at McCoy. Doesn't look like they want to throw it to you. Probably not, agreed McCoy. You can take it easy. When he got back to the huddle, he told the quarterback, my guy is sort of short. Let me come back for it and throw it to me high. Right, agreed Wainwright. Same play. Let's block this time. They lined up again, and McCoy tried not to even look at the younger cadet who was dogging him. At the snap, he ran straight down the middle, and the defender was running right with him. Then McCoy stopped short and took a few steps back. Wainwright was looking at him, and he cut loose with the ball, high as expected. The unlucky freshman had to skid to a stop and double back. He didn't have much energy to jump, and McCoy plucked the ball off his fingertips and cradled it to his chest. He was running down the field, thinking it was TD time, when he heard what sounded like a bull behind him. McCoy peered over his shoulder to see the cocky kid closing fast. In the cool air he was snorting steam, and his arms and legs were churning like an engine. The freshman was gaining, so McCoy dashed for the sidelines. Only there weren't any sidelines, because this wasn't a real field, so he ran off the lawn toward a fence. His pursuer kept coming, and he leapt at McCoy. He thudded into McCoy's midsection, and the two of them crashed through a row of hedges. They rolled up against the fence, with McCoy wheezing and gasping for breath. At once, shrieking sirens started to blare, and the area was bathed in throbbing pink light. You idiot, snapped McCoy. I'm sorry, said the kid. I forgot it was touch, not tackle. That was stupid enough, but then you ran us into a security fence. What? McCoy threw the football, and it bounced off an invisible force field. The freshman stood up and ran his hands along the barrier, which twinkled at his touch. We're in trouble, said the young cadet. No kidding. With a groan, McCoy sat up and gazed past the broken shrubbery at the lawn. The other players had run for it, he couldn't see any of them. This close to winter break, who wanted to stick around and get into trouble? He wagged his finger at the young cadet. If you're going to wash out of the academy, that's fine with me. But next time leave me out of it. Maybe there's a way out of this mess. The freshman gave him a boyish grin. McCoy could only scowl as redshirt security forces surrounded them. He saw one phaser, but most of the officers had tricorders and were scanning the intruders. Starfleet security, said a stern voice. Identify yourselves. Cadet Leonard H. McCoy, Medical Branch. Cadet James T. Kirk, First Year. Chapter 2. The next day went as badly as possible, with McCoy doing poorly on his stasis exam, he was sure. He was barely awake, after spending most of the night in the custody of Starfleet security. Then, he had the entire day to dread his appointment with Admiral Ybarra. The superintendent of Starfleet Academy had his office inside a clear pyramid, on the roof of Quadrangle C. Interior walls gave the impression of building blocks that didn't exist, because the outer walls were smooth. McCoy paused as he got off the lift, and stared at the imposing structure. The door of another lift opened behind him, and McCoy turned to see Cadet Kirk stroll jauntily off. The idiot actually smiled at McCoy as if he were glad to see him.
"What are you so happy about?" growled McCoy.
Kirk shrugged. "I've never met Admiral Yabara before. This is a chance to impress him."
"Impress him?" roared McCoy.
"You're here because you crashed into a security fence in the middle of the night. They don't give medals for that." The cadet smiled confidently and strode toward the gleaming pyramid. The doors opened at his approach, and McCoy hunched his shoulders and followed him in. They came to attention in front of an ensign in the lobby, and she pointed them toward the admiral's inner office. McCoy glanced upward at the clear ceiling, which softly filtered a gray San Francisco day. He could tell by the slope of the ceiling that they were delving deeper into the pyramid, toward its center. Kirk bravely led the way, marching to his own funeral, thought McCoy. They both slowed to enter the center of the pyramid, where four translucent walls met at a pinnacle overhead. The ceiling was so high that the office felt like a cathedral. The meticulous admiral had added to the pyramid's design with lots of stark, clear furniture. McCoy would have been afraid to sit on any of it. Yabara was a small man of Eurasian descent. He sat at his translucent desk going over some documents with a female captain. He ignored McCoy and Kirk, but she glanced at them with mild curiosity. The admiral and the captain conversed in low tones until they finally agreed.
"At ease," said the admiral.
"This is Captain Varina, and we've been discussing your misconduct."
"Permission to speak, sir?" asked Kirk.
The admiral peered at him through sharp black eyes.
"If you're going to make some kind of excuse, you can forget it. That was a sensitive research and development site you crashed into. Even if it was accidental, it was still a breach of security, and we take a dim view of breaches of security."
He stared from Kirk to McCoy.
"Do I make myself clear?"
"Yes, sir," they both answered.
Kirk snapped his mouth shut.
The admiral folded his hands in front of him, "Seeing as the two of you have so much excess energy, perhaps it would be a good idea if you volunteered for one of our service clubs. Captain Varina has a few suggestions."
The woman cleared her throat.
"Cadet McCoy, the Disaster Relief Service Club, is in particular need of medics. You qualify with your pre-medical training, and we are conducting training classes next week, during the break."
McCoy gasped.
"You mean, I wouldn't get to go home during break?"
"Cadet," said Admiral Yabara, "Starfleet is about duty. The Disaster Relief Service Club is in urgent need of medics. It's a dirty, dangerous job, but you get to save lives. Moreover, I would think that the break wouldn't be enjoyable knowing you have disciplinary action looming over your heads. Am I right?"
"Yes, sir," answered McCoy, snapping to attention.
"I volunteer."
The admiral nodded with approval.
"There is a membership drive going on now, in Quadrangle A. Report over there and sign up."
"I'll do disaster relief too," offered Kirk.
Captain Varina smiled slightly.
"No, Cadet Kirk, we have another service club that is also dirty and dangerous. Would you like to try that?"
"Yes, sir," said Kirk proudly.
"Good."
She nodded with approval.
"I'll put you down for mess duty. Report to the kitchen."
Kirk gulped.
"The kitchen?
Mess duty?"
"Yes, and I like my potatoes sliced thin," added Yabara.
"But sir, this Sawbones gets exciting duty, and I get kitchen duty.
It isn't fair."
The admiral stiffened in his chair.
"Let me tell you something, mister, there is nothing fair about Starfleet. Today you may get mess duty, and tomorrow you may be the youngest captain in the fleet. You have to take the good with the bad."
"Dismissed."
McCoy and Kirk hustled out, heads downcast. They strolled through the pyramid until they were outside on the roof again, both of them glum and deep in thought.
Kirk pounded his fist into his palm.
"I'm going to take over that kitchen and turn it into the best kitchen Starfleet Academy ever had."
"Good for you," said McCoy.
"Meanwhile, you ruined my winter break, and I won't get home again for 8 months, if then. I needed to spend some time with my dad.
Homesick, huh?
Kirk nodded sympathetically.
You have to get over that.
Oh, listen to the voice of experience.
They stopped at the lift that went to ground level.
McCoy let Kirk get on, then he stepped back.
You're not coming with me, asked the young cadet.
No, said McCoy, I never want to see you again.
You're nothing but trouble.
It might be hard to avoid me.
See you around, Sawbones.
The lift door shut on James T. Kirk, and took him out of McCoy's life, forever.
Or so he hoped.
The dejected cadet made his way to Quadrangle A, where the recruiting drive for the service clubs was taking place. He still couldn't believe he was going to be stuck in San Francisco over winter break. Not only that, but he had probably done badly on the stasis exam. Maybe Starfleet wasn't the place for him after all.
McCoy tried to concentrate on the words of Admiral Ybarra.
Disaster relief is a dirty, dangerous job, but you get to save lives.
Wasn't that the reason he wanted to be a doctor?
Then what was he complaining about?
Maybe it would be fun.
At least it sounded better than kitchen duty.
But he couldn't stop thinking about the lost opportunity to go home.
He was frightened by the course he was on, a course that would take him into space, to far-off worlds.
Maybe his yearning for home was his heart telling him that he was making a mistake.
Maybe he just wanted to see friendly faces and sleep under his old quilt.
The worst of it was that they were expecting him, and he would have to call to tell them he wasn't coming.
McCoy's spirits were still low when he followed several other cadets into the lobby of Quadrangle A. Four color-coded elevators surrounded him and branched off toward different dorm towers, but he was looking for the recruiters. He was thinking that he might as well get it over with.
He found directions on the information console, which told new members to go to the recreation room.
McCoy went down a flight of stairs and found himself in a game room that had everything, from ping pong tables to three-dimensional chess. Card tables and signs were set up for the various service clubs.
He saw the mechanics club, which recycled old equipment into useful stuff.
There was also the hospice club, which visited sick and elderly people.
There was another club to work on archaeological digs, one running a food drive, another planting trees, and many more.
Seeing all this goodwill, McCoy wondered why he had never volunteered for a service club before.
He knew they existed and that they did good work, plus they looked good on one's record.
But he had always been so wrapped up in his own problems that he had never had time to volunteer.
Or so he thought.
McCoy was finally feeling good about this sudden turn of events when he spotted the table for disaster relief. As he strode closer, he only saw one person at the table, a tall, dark-haired cadet who looked very somber. Then McCoy spotted the pointed ears and odd skin tone, and he stopped short.
Was that a Vulcan?
He hadn't talked to any Vulcans before, although he had seen a few of them around campus.
Did they really have green blood?
He wondered.
McCoy put on a cheerful face as he approached the table.
I'd like to sign up.
He added nervously, in fact, I have to sign up, if you get my drift.
The Vulcan raised an eyebrow, but gave him no other expression.
This is a volunteer club.
Would you like me to tell you about it?
McCoy lowered his voice.
There's no need.
The Admiral suggested I sign up.
Are you volunteering or not? Asked the solemn Vulcan.
No, I didn't volunteer, answered McCoy, getting angry as he thought about what had happened to him.
It was all the fault of that stupid freshman, Kirk.
Then you should not join.
This is a volunteer service club, and to join against your will is illogical.
McCoy blinked in amazement.
What kind of cockeyed, bubble-brained thinking is that?
It is called logic.
Listen, you.
Do you have a name?
Yes, I do.
Spock.
Okay, Cadet Spock, does this service club need medics?
Yes, we are in dire need of medics.
Well, I'm a medical student. I already have most of the training, so go ahead and sign me up.
The Vulcan held up an electronic clipboard.
We have a volunteer form, and only volunteers are allowed to fill it out.
You do not appear to be a volunteer.
McCoy was sputtering now.
Listen, you pointy-eared popinjay, what would it take for you to let me join?
A full understanding of what you are joining, answered the Vulcan.
Before choosing disaster relief, I studied every service club thoroughly.
This club makes the most effective use of academy resources and personnel.
Even so, we have been understaffed for 4.3 years, resulting in a 12% decrease in efficiency from our peak performance.
Good help is hard to find, McCoy grumbled.
Spock nodded.
Precisely.
Certain aspects of this club repel volunteers, such as the rigorous training and the likelihood of being called to a dangerous mission any time.
All volunteers should be aware that there is danger and grueling work involved.
You make it sound real attractive, said McCoy.
What do I care if the superintendent of the academy likes me or not?
I can always be a small-town doctor somewhere.
The Vulcan added, last year we saved 312 lives on 5 different planets.
By George, exclaimed McCoy, that sounds like a logical thing to do.
Okay, I volunteer.
Spock offered him the clipboard and a stylus.
You are aware that the first week of winter break is devoted to training.
McCoy's shoulders slumped.
Yes, I know that.
Do you think we can go home for the second week?
I presume so, but you should ask Captain Raelius, our faculty advisor.
McCoy nodded and finished filling out the form.
What is the training like?
I do not know.
I will be taking the training for the first time myself.
And you're the recruiter?
McCoy shook his head.
No wonder they can't get anybody to sign up.
I am merely filling in, answered Spock.
I know what you mean, said McCoy.
Just as he was about to walk away, an attractive female cadet strolled up to the table.
She had beautiful brown hair, and she smiled pleasantly at both of them.
My name is Lisa Donald, and I'd like some information on disaster relief.
We have been understaffed for 4.3 years, resulting in a 12% decrease in efficiency from our peak performance and evaluation.
McCoy stepped in front of the Vulcan and turned on the Southern charm.
What my friend is trying to say, Lisa, is that we really need you to volunteer.
But only if you want to save lives, go to exotic places, and take a few risks.
We do all the things you joined Starfleet to do.
That sounds great, said Lisa Donald.
What is the training like?
Oh, it's fun, claimed McCoy.
It only takes a week, and there's lots of fresh air and exercise.
Spock nodded thoughtfully.
There will be considerable exercise.
I'll sign up, said Lisa.
Spock handed her the clipboard.
McCoy smiled at the young lady.
A wise choice.
Can I buy you a cup of coffee to celebrate?
Not right now, thanks.
I'm meeting my boyfriend.
You're meeting with your boyfriend, said McCoy glumly. Did you ever have one of those days when you should have stood in bed?
Spock raised an eyebrow.
Standing in bed sounds like a pointless exercise.
It's not pointless, said McCoy.
If I had stood in bed last night, none of this would be happening to me now.
That is illogical, said Spock.
Your present would have occurred to you no matter what your posture in bed last night.
You're as dense as a 2x4, McCoy accused the Vulcan.
Have you listened to anything I said?
Excuse me, said Lisa.
I've got to get going.
We don't always argue like this, do we?
No, answered Spock.
Under normal circumstances, we are too busy.
Good.
Lisa handed Spock the clipboard and hurried off.
See you around.
McCoy shook his head and sighed.
My luck has got to change sometime, doesn't it?
There is no such thing as luck, replied Spock.
It is illogical.
McCoy rubbed his eyes.
Let me see if I can get a straight answer out of you.
Is there a booth where I can call home?
The Vulcan pointed to an alcove in the corner.
Over there, I believe. Thank you, said McCoy with an exaggerated bow. The medical student twisted his hands as he walked toward the communications booth. How was he going to phrase this to his father? He couldn't make it sound as if it was his idea to stay in San Francisco over the break. But he didn't want to explain exactly why he had volunteered. He settled into the booth and looked at the screen. Even though there was no door on the booth, noise inhibitors blocked out the sounds from the recreation room. Computer, he said, I'd like to call a number in Georgia. He gave the number and settled back in his chair. Your name and account, asked the computer. McCoy answered with his name and his academy account. He still had plenty of credit to make calls, as he hardly made any. McCoy twisted nervously in his seat as he waited to be connected. He still didn't know what he was going to say. When his father's lined, cheerful face appeared on the screen, he nearly began to cry. I have bad news, Dad, he blurted out. You didn't flunk out, did you? His dad asked with concern. Not yet, answered McCoy. But I can't come home over the winter break, at least not until the end of it. McCoy's father looked even sadder than when he thought his son was flunking. Oh, I see. Well, everybody will be disappointed. What have you got, some extra studies? Not exactly. McCoy had never been good at lying, especially to his dad. It was a family trait to stick with the truth. Dad, I got in trouble for doing something stupid. To make amends, I joined a service club, Disaster Relief, and we have training next week. A smile creased his father's face. Disaster relief can get pretty rough. You take care of yourself, son. There will always be lots of other times we can be together. Yeah, I guess so. McCoy wasn't so sure about that. After medical school, Starfleet could ship him off to the farthest corner of the galaxy, and his dad wasn't getting any younger. As soon as the training is over, he promised, I'll let you know if there's any chance of me getting home. Just do a good job, and make us proud of you. The older man must have seen something in his son's eyes, because he asked, Are you happy there? No, not really, admitted McCoy. But I've made too many mistakes already, so I'm going to stick it out at the academy. I don't want to fall behind again. It doesn't matter where you finish the race, said his dad, only that you finish it. Don't worry about us, we'll save you some catfish. McCoy smiled. Thanks, Dad. My love to everybody. Goodbye. Bye, Leonard. His dad smiled, but his lower lip quivered a bit. The cadet turned off the computer, and the screen went blank. He sat staring at the dark phosphors for a moment, wondering if he would ever know what he really wanted. He hadn't gone home for years, so why should he be so upset about missing this trip? What did he really want, all of space, or a small town in Georgia? It just seemed as if there wasn't enough time to do anything. Not enough time to study, to visit his family, or figure out where he was going with his life. How could someone even find the time to have a girlfriend? His luck had to get better, decided McCoy. Despite what the Vulcan had said, he knew there was such a thing as luck. Right now, his was all bad. End of chapter. This book is part of our exclusive series available to Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to this entire book, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and may you live long and prosper.